University of Western Australia. Toby is the director of the ANZ-funded Data Capture and Seeding the Commons projects, and he also serves as the director of the UWA node of the Australian Social Science Data Archive and manages the Scholars Centre in the UWA Library. Between 2005 and 2010, he directed the digital services of the ARC Network for Early European Research, which is a very successful network. And today he's going to be speaking on the topic of archiving humanities data for e-research, conceptual and technical issues. Please welcome Toby Burrows.
While we're getting that on the screen, I suppose I should remark that when I looked at this title, I rather regretted having chosen it, because all four terms are actually really quite problematical. So I'll probably be doing reasonably well today if I can give you some ideas of what I think we might mean by humanities data. Possibly the easiest to define is the term humanities, which probably does need some definition. That's the Academy's list of the disciplinary areas. Those disciplines represent a huge variety of methods and approaches to research. So archaeology, there's a lot of scientific techniques. Philosophy is mainly linguistic and logical. So what I'm going to do, rather than trying to define humanities data as a whole, I'm going to focus on history, partly because I know a bit about it, but mainly because it does actually encompass a wide range of methods itself. And to give you an idea of the breadth, I'm going to draw some examples from a historical school called the Annales School, which is influential French researchers. See some of the topics there that they covered in their more influential books. They used a wide range of different approaches and methods and sources. So they did traditional document-based and text-based history, but they also used all those other approaches that I've listed there. Worth noticing the end of that list. Quotation, tomorrow's historian will be a program of looking at the no longer exists. And they did a mixture of individual research and team-based large-scale research. So what I'm going to focus on is the distinctively humanities approaches within that list, which is basically the document-based, object-based, text-based part of that collection of methods. And historians are very reluctant to talk about their methods listed in print. So I was really quite surprised and rather heartened to see that Keith Thomas, in the fairly recent issue of the London Review of Books, actually talked about his methodology. Keith Thomas is a very eminent and influential British historian. He's now age 77, I've worked out, still working. And he's got a method which might look idiosyncratic, but it's probably not untypical of traditional pre-computer type historical research. So basically he makes notes, then cuts up his notes, files them in envelopes, and when he has to write something, he picks an envelope. There are all these notes and sources to start writing. He seems to at least be reasonably well organised. He can get historical data that looks a bit more like that, which I found in an archival collection that we own. That's obviously based on analysis of 14th century documents, but there's no annotation or citation or anything, so trying to track down where that information came from. It's a bit arbitrary. Generalize a bit, I think we can from Keith Thomas as an example, these are some of the types of personal data, right, that historians put together. Some of the kinds of materials that they use to record them. This is gone, the electronic, pre-electronic era. And if you, as I occasionally do, get shown around the offices of retiring or recently retired historians and ask if you'd like to take their archives into the library, you see the whole rooms full of this kind of stuff. The only thing I've really added there is the sharing aspect at the end, which Thomas doesn't talk about, but it's really a major part of historical research. It's interesting to try and map these against a couple of attempts to identify what John Unsworth called scholarly primitives. So the basic type of research activities in humanities areas, humanities disciplines. Okay, I've just discovered I haven't got the latest version of this loaded. Anyway, I'll improvise. Well, it means there are fewer slides, so I might just get through time. There should be another slide that actually maps things like annotations, but you can do it as an exercise. It's fairly obvious that those kinds of data to map reasonably well to some of these scholarly primitives. The more interesting question, I think, is how much has really changed in the digital world? Again, I'm talking here about historians who are mainly document-based, text-based in research. And I think we find that, for the most part, although they are now using software of various kinds, databases, downloading electronic copies of things rather than keeping physical copies, the basic suite of data is pretty much the same. The only major area where probably points of change is the sharing side of things, because collaboration services are beginning to permeate all those other types of things. Collaborative service that we've developed as part of the research network, which is a national wiki with 350 people. But historians' individual personal data is only half of the story, because the other side of it is the what's been called the industrialization of historical data. So that's the collections and the metadata of cultural heritage institutions. They're the custodians of primary sources, publications, things like that. And that photograph is actually of a guy called Sir Thomas Phillips. He was a great collector in the 19th century of medieval manuscripts and books. He had 60,000 medieval manuscripts. They're still appearing, but it's scattered all over the world. We own one in Australia. But he was one of the last great collectors who was trying to do a personal collection on that sort of industrial scale, because he didn't actually get time to do the research. But he opened it up to other researchers and colleagues. So public collections of books and archival sources, public metadata services, most obviously library catalogs, and the crucial point, I think, the data that's coming out of this sort of industrial stream, if you like, are often kept pretty separate from the personal collections of data that Keith Thomas are putting together. And that's really accelerating the digital world. So I really need to tell you all this, but there are large scale digital libraries, metadata collections, commercial ownership is a problem. But there's still relatively little connection between these digital services and what historians are building to the working relations. See the possibly the presentation that's supporting annotations, things like text reading in Europe, and now trying to provide a collaborative space for text manipulation annotation. I came up with an incredibly oversimplified diagram, which is one of the number two map, to map the relationship between what individual researchers, individual historians are doing and institutions. So down the left-hand side, you've got all those categories of data that come out of it, like Keith Thomas. On the right-hand side, those boxes include huge numbers of different services, many of which are not interoperable at all. And one thing to notice is that the little metadata descriptions box doesn't necessarily mediate between what the researchers are doing and the collections. So in some ways it's adding to the criticism. So I suppose the question is really, is there a solution that could make that a bit more operable, easy to navigate, to attempt to at least provide an initial answer to that. I'm going to work through an example, which is medieval manuscripts. They're the main body of evidence, data used in the work of medieval historians. And they study them for a whole variety of reasons, content, and their format, and their history requirements. They do all sorts of things with them. They describe them, edit them, describe them, make them available in various ways. There's a huge range of problems. The current state of the art is chaotic, to say the least. There are lots of services, but it's incredibly difficult to make effective use of them. It's almost impossible to ask large-scale research questions about that body of evidence, that body of data. We don't even know how many medieval manuscripts have survived as artists. Ask a research question across the whole body of evidence and be sure that you've actually covered the whole range of data. The major underlying factor, I think, the major reason for that is because of the semantic complexity of the field of knowledge. It's called the heterogeneity problem. So that's a printed description of the manuscript in the State Library of Victoria. It's actually the first half of it. It assumes a whole lot of semantic frameworks, concepts, a body of knowledge. If you try and what I then try to do is color code that to try and point out some of the semantic elements in there. So you've got places, dark red, names in red, people associated with manuscripts, titles, identifiers, the various numerical identifiers. This is just one manuscript. Time periods, materials, scripts, attempted to do subjects, contents, structure, and arrangement, but they're also partners as well. So that's one embodiment, if you like, in semantic complexity. And that has resulted in a huge proliferation of different digital services. So I tried there to organize roughly around the semantic type of information that they're dealing with. And people have tried to aggregate some of these things, but really all they've done is build bigger silos or bigger digital islands, whatever metaphor you like. So what I'm suggesting is, given the semantic complexity, we should look at how taking a linked data approach to this might help to cope with some of that complexity. Case of manuscripts, there are some things you could do if you turn the semantic content manuscript descriptions and manuscript transcriptions as well into the data type entities. So you can start, you should start by having a global enterprise of manuscripts. And you can map between the various terminologies as well, track the relationships between manuscripts and different versions and dependents. Use data for those kinds of functions. So identifying entities, find those, mapping terminology, browsing and searching, and linking, in particular, bridging that gap between scholarly activity, scholarly data, and the collection, industrial, library, museum type data as well. Then if you simplify that diagram even further, I suppose what I'm envisaging there is you put a big data or entities layer in the middle there, and that's going to simplify all those relationships considerably. That's just kind of switching mechanism between what researchers are doing and what the institutions are doing. It does have potential implications. Major implications for the design of information services in this area. Institutions should be concentrating on exposing their data in formats. Researchers should be building their annotations onto the entities rather than onto the digital objects themselves, or even onto the metadata and the collection descriptions. I'm part of a European group which has put together a roadmap for doing this in Europe. Potential sources, and we're currently trying to get. We have got commitment from major libraries in Europe, and I think two from several commercial firms that own this kind of data as well. They're willing to provide their data for this kind of purpose. I think this kind of approach would actually be worth thinking about for the humanities generally, not just for getting research. And also then thinking about its implications for how you might design and humanities that you are now. Very much.
Does anyone have a question? We've got time for just one.
Answers.
Well, that's a good